introduce the moderator of the session, Pushpalata. Pushpalata is a senior quality engineering manager at VMware Bangalore. She has 20 plus years of rich IT experience. She has experience across multiple domains like storage, security, cloud, ERP, CRM, satellite communications, and virtualization. She holds Bachelor of Engineering degree in Electronics and Communication. She is currently pursuing her PhD in strategy. She is also undertaking a course on CSR and sustainability. She is one of the city directors for Bangalore's Women Who Code chapter. She is also a core team member of VMware's diversity and inclusion team. Welcome, Pushpa. Nice to have you. Stage is yours. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks, Hussaina, for that wonderful introduction. Hi, everyone. Welcome back. Good afternoon. So quite inspiring talks from morning and a lot of takeaways for me. I'm sure it is the same case with you all too, right? So I'd like to start with one of the question that came in the morning sessions. One of the question was, should I leave my company to be an innovator, right? Or to be, you know, to work more on innovation, on new ideas and thoughts, right? Answer, all of us know that it is no, right? This is a good context to start the panel or discussion now. How do we build the next generation of entrepreneurship, right? With that context, I would like to welcome our esteemed panelists for today's discussion. To start with, I would like to welcome Shiv Kumar, Senior Director of GE Healthcare. Shiva is a contemporary corporate leader with 20 plus years of experience in IT across multiple industry segments like logistics, aviation, energy, healthcare, and also domains spanning commercial, field services, supply chain, and quality lean with proven leadership credentials in various capacities. Starting from his early career application development to process improvement and control, transactional, lean, program management, establishing strong engineering practices, etc. Shiva currently leads the global e-commerce digital strategy and engineering as part of the customer digital experience portfolio. And also he's a site leader for the digital service technology teams based out of Bangalore, India. Welcome, Shiva.
Thank you, Pushpa. Can you hear me?
Yes, Shiva. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Now I'd like to welcome Sunita Mohanty, Director of Trust and Safety, Google Singapore. Sunita has more than 20 years of leadership experience in technology and innovation. Her team's mission is to promote trust in Google and ensure user safety by fighting a wide spectrum of online abuse like fraud, spam, data security, child safety, etc. In addition to her current role, Sunita has also worked closely with state and central governments in India in creating a connected, digitized, and sustainable ecosystem in the state. She also leads community outreach activities to create awareness around online safety, data privacy, and women empowerment across India. Sunita has an engineering degree and an MBA in marketing and IT. Sunita is a firm believer of lift as you climb. She led the Women Network for Google India and Singapore, and she's an active community advocate for Women Who Code and Women Tech Makers. Welcome, Sunita.
Thank you, Pushpa, and nice to be in this session. And hi, Shiva, nice to meet you again.
Hey, Sunita.
Thank you. Now, I'd like to welcome Lata, the VP Power Train Systems, Robert Bosch. Lata and her organization are responsible for the customer engineering projects, function development, and calibration for global customers in EU, AM, and APAC areas for Power Train. He's a graduate in Applied Electronics and Instrumentation from CET Trivandrum and has 28 years of industry experience. Lata has a diverse work experience in the areas of software development and architecture, Global Project Management, Sales and Business Development and Delivery of Global Projects. She's very passionate about leadership and building powerful technology teams, which creates value and differentiation for business. She's also an active contributor in diversity topics at RBEI. Coaching is an area of passion for Lata, and she's also a certified executive coach from IEC and CFI. With that, welcome, Lata. Lata, anybody hear us? Hello?
Hi, can you?
I think she's just making her way in.
Yes.
Thank you
for the introduction, and happy to meet Shiva, Sumita again. Yeah, thank you for joining Shiva, Sumita, Lata. So with that, let me start with the first common question on the intrapreneurship, right? Intrapreneurship is an intrapreneurship within a dominant and matured organizational ecosystem, right? I would like to request each one of you to share the top two things that for you while fostering intrapreneurial culture and ideas within your ecosystem. Would you like to go first, Shiva? Thank you.
Yeah, firstly, thank you for the nice introduction, and it's nice to be on this panel, sharing some distinguished people. Great opportunity to learn from myself as well from other experiences. Coming to that question, what's the top two things that work for me? One is, first of all, we are in organizations like Google and Bosch, large organizations, large enterprises that have had a history of doing things. So the two things that I've always found very is one is creating that culture of questioning the status quo. Ask why, be respectful of what. A new idea doesn't mean good. It didn't make sense for the future. So be respectful for what's been built. Understand the ecosystem that you're in. Understand you're trying to solve, and explore faster that can make it even better, or take it to the next level, or transform it. So partly it comes from my lean background, having constantly looked at how can we make things better. Try to build that culture with the team. So in short, it's question the status quo, but be respectful while doing it. The second thing is, in large organizations like ours, we are programmed, generally programmed to be successful. One thing is not working fine, we tend not to stop at it, we keep going till we make it happen. But when you're looking at something like an entrepreneurial idea, you must be okay to fail. The thing that you want to help build as a culture in the team is constantly look at ways to make things happen. But if something is not working, don't be afraid to fail, and don't be afraid to say, this isn't working, we may want to stop this. And if something is working out, it is most important for a large organization like ours to shop the idea around. Because when you have an idea that is new, there are also going to be a lot of people who may have other inputs into it, then you might have to find promoters for it before you can actually take it into the future. So be open to shop it around, be idea open to share, generate excitement for the idea. All of these things are things that have worked out for me.
Thank you. Thank you, Shiva. Sumita, would you like to go ahead?
Yeah, I can go next. Thanks, Shiva. I mean, Shiva has actually addressed a lot of things that are going to be very common across our talks, but I will still talk from the point of view of working for Google, and Google being known for its innovation. I think corporate intrapreneurship has immense potential to create new innovations. And the reason we say is, if you look at products like Gmail or AdSense, etc., all of that have been created because the organization has given people the capacity to work 20% on something new. So I'll first want to address why is it important. And one is, yes, the new innovation gives you new validity in a competitive environment. It also keeps the teams motivated because the broader team is not engaged in the monotonous work. They find capacity to do something beyond their expectation, and that should always be encouraged. And then it keeps individual skills relevant because you always try new things. You're always trying to create a new process, a new product, or new innovation, and that keeps your skill relevant. Because you never know at what point of time in this really digital world you become redundant. Now, the two things or three things that I think is really important. One is you have to create opportunities for innovation in your immediate teams, which is how do you create space for teams to step out of what they are doing on a day-to-day basis to pursue new things. So that's one. Second is echoing everything that Shiva said is how do you enable people to fail? Or if they fail, how do you really give them the safety net for fail, to fail? So rewarding and recognizing innovation is also important because that creates an environment where everybody else feels like they will want to do and innovate and do different things. And third is always find sponsors, because in a large organization, you have to find support agents that help you with new ideas and new thoughts. So these are my three takeaways.
Sure. Thanks, Sunita. Lata, would like to hear your thoughts. Lata, we're not able to hear you now.
Difficult to be the third one because, you know, two excellent people. Yeah. But I would like to comparison to a pure startup entrepreneur. The advantage of entrepreneurs inside a corporate are the large resource pool that you have at your disposal. Yeah, as well as the money on offer to kickstart creative projects within the company. And I might find and the experience which I have over the last 28 years in corporate. There are two things that have worked for me. The first thing is to have a right organizational setup, yeah, which most of us forget to do. So the sponsorship of the top management is the key. We need to have leaders and mentors where there is no chain of command. And we should have a much more flatter structure in the organization. The key is to capture the upside of the corporate in everything that you do. But at the same time, you kind of minimize the bureaucratic exposure, yeah, of this entrepreneurship teams into the hierarchy and the complexities and processes and other things which exist in corporate, obviously. Yeah, probably Google is an exception, but I'm sure GE, Bosch, everywhere it exists. And these mentors need to be focused both ways, which is inward as well as towards the market. And they should not be carrying this big corporate legacy. And one thing which we very well need to keep in mind is that someone who performs exceptionally well in an established and conventional business is not a guaranteed success when it comes to a startup mode and an entrepreneurship. So this is something which we, with mistakes the corporate make, that we always put successful people there and sometimes it doesn't work. The number two point, I think to some extent Sunita addressed it, but it's the mindset and the culture. Yeah. So one is the culture that accepts failure, and a culture in which I would say that the freedom symbol is much more important than the status symbol. And here we are talking about, you know, the other factors like agility, innovative mindset, and other things that are required. But what we need is actually a marriage of ideation as well as the collaboration. And coming across, we also have the usage of different methodologies like agile. Then, business canvas models and design thinking and other things to put that structure into innovation. What we need to keep in mind and what is a big no is that the standard tool that I use to track a standard project, that should be kept away from the entrepreneurship team. Yeah? And that actually is a big boost for them to act independently and have more creativity. So this is my take on that.
Sure. Very interesting to hear all your thoughts. So with that, I think that leads to a question in my mind, Shiva. With your experience, I would like to know you to address this. What are the kind of gaps that you have seen, especially between the demand of the market and the productive capacity in our organizational innovation ecosystem? It would be great if you can share the success stories wherein you have successfully navigated these gaps and the resulting ecosystem challenges.
Sure. Before I answer, can you all hear me all right? Is there a lag? Is there a voice? Okay. That's what you just asked is a pretty common challenge, I would say, in large organizations. We've got a lot of priorities that are built for the year. that we have to adhere to and the needs of the business, and those priorities usually take precedence when it comes to new part to probably part the idea that so that's a common challenge, I would say. But the thing is, it doesn't happen in a vacuum. You know, you can't just say you five guys at room and go and innovate. It doesn't generally work that way. It can, but what I have found personally is making that innovation mindset, the thought process, like Lata was mentioning as well as Sunita, making that part of the process of the that you're working, a huge difference on how you can between what the business needs and and when I say that, what I mean is, it could be, you know, we have like, I'll give you some products that are customer facing, that are customer digital experience. One of the products that we launched actually a year and a half ago is Expert. This is a tool that is being used for remote learning. Today, in today's world, right now, we are seeing a massive increase in demand for this product. What it actually does is, the doctors are all sitting, doctors and the technicians are all sitting in the, they're trying to utilize their, and so we have all these big systems that we deploy. You need to know how to use those controls. A lot of training that happens. How do we enable this training? And that is the whole concept behind Digital Expert. We have all connectivity between the hospital and GE people that are sitting in a remote location that can actually connect your system, teach you while you're utilizing the system itself, teach you remotely, help you diagnose remotely. That was an idea that started 2 years ago, but it became a product. It became part of how we operate now. And this whole innovation process has been part of making it a business priority. Therefore, the gap, adjusting the gap, is when an idea comes, the idea can come from anywhere. Once the idea comes, we have a very standard process of ensuring that we vet the idea, get some initial pilot, and then make that a part of our 3-year plan or a 2-year plan. And there are options to change over the period. There are other things that we do. There are intern programs where we can add capacity for things that we want to incubate as ideas. We use that capacity. We have hackathons that we run that allow us to, you know, again, look at ideas that can potentially be taken to production in the future. I have a couple more things that I can talk about, but I'm sure there are other questions that will come where I can bring those up. Then there's stretch assignments, things like that. So there is capacity that we block, like Sunita mentioned in one of our responses, but also try and make this.
Thank you for your thoughts. Just to update you, in between, your voice quality is going a little, you know, bad. Maybe you might want to, you know, see to that. But yeah, beginning it was good and at the end also, but in between, yeah. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. So,
okay,
yeah. So, if I taking the same the thought process, right, Sunita? Any change is hard in any enterprise, right? Being an entrepreneur, how you could change and strengthen the existing organization, ecosystem, and culture towards entrepreneurship?
So Pushpa, I'd like to start with a personal anecdote, and this was really helpful for me to learn the process of innovation and entrepreneurship. So when I joined Google, I had come to Google with multiple years of corporate experience. And there is this concept of one-on-one that happens with your manager. Sometimes your manager is a director, or I even had worked very closely with the VP of the India org at that point of time. And in the one-on-one, which is usually 30 minutes, there were a lot of questions asked to me. Like every time I would go, it would be very open-ended one-on-one on what would you do here? How would you deal with this issue? What are the different ways of looking at this problem? What do you think is the best way we should tackle this problem? So every time, I came back very empowered out of that one-on-one, because it almost felt that I was empowered to make the change and I could take a problem and own it. So for me, that was really important, that how do people inculcate the culture of innovation that comes actually on a day-to-day basis and interactions, peer-to-peer, one to the manager, as well as from a manager to a reporting. Now, a couple of things as a leader that I've realized is, to bring in a change, first you need a vision. And the vision doesn't have to be something great, but you have to really create an aspirational enthusiasm to the vision. Like, how do you create hope for people that things will change? You have a better life going forward because of the changes we are making. And that comes with asking a lot of questions and rallying people along. Now, change management is hard. Change management usually is done at three levels. First is self, because you can't change the organization if you don't start with self, which is that if I am creating a vision, how do I deal with a change myself? What is my current challenge? What is my role as a change leader? How do I do things differently? How do I ensure that I have the leadership capability to navigate the team through change? So whether it's me or my teams, I have to make sure everybody is able to deal with it, and that starts with me. The second is others, which is my people, my team, my peers. How do I navigate, help them navigate through change, especially when a lot of people do not have either control over the change or do not have a choice? So the change probably happened because you didn't have a choice. Somebody had a vision, but how do you really navigate people? How do you respond? How do you build relationship and persuade? It could be your supporters, detractors, or even people who are sitting across the fence to get on board with what you want to do. The third thing, and this does not have to happen at a leadership level, even individually, when I'm dealing with a project, I am doing the self-innovation. These are things that I need to think about. How do I deal with the change myself? How do I bring the teams along? And then how do I bring the organization along, which is the broader team? And that would mean cultural and political realities. How do we deal? Like, for example, I forge a network of change agents through the organization. So usually if you're leading a team of 100, 200, or you have a peer group of 20, all 20 will not agree with your ideas. You have to actually create change agents who actually then create a viral need in the organization or a hope in the organization. How do you influence the managers? How do you influence the teams? How do you influence across the organization that the change is right? So some of these are important. But the most important, and I'm going to call this out again and again, is you have to reward success, but at the same time, you also have to reward failures, because you have to recognize that you have to create an opportunity for people to be able to take risks.
Sure. Thanks, Amita, for that. So I could connect the dots from morning discussion. So reinforcing with, you know, all your talks, right? Whether to make a resolution, that's where it's coming as an vision, right? So yeah, definitely, you know. Thank you. Thanks for your thoughts. Sunita, I would like to hear from your experience on while implementing the intrapreneurship, right? In your intrapreneurial leadership journey, how did you resolve the conflicts that might have arise due to strategy or on leadership or, you know, towards resources or culture conflicts? Any thoughts?
Okay. So I would say that it's no secret that the organization of corporates, they are designed to ensure the success of the established business. Yeah. So mostly we are designed like that. Yeah. And the new businesses are very different. And they also have cultures on their own. Their financial and business model, they don't fit into the standard one right from day one. So they become clearer as the teams try new things, they meet new customers, they try, you know, new applications that develop and so on. So which means, because of the high level of uncertainty which is associated in the beginning, we also need to have some kind of an adaptive organizational culture that needs to support. Yeah, and it coming to this conflict, there are a whole lot of questions come when we talk about entrepreneurship inside the bigger corporate. One is that, you know, how do you separate these entrepreneur teams from the core teams? Yeah, how do you make them agile? How can one set of people be more agile than the other? Yeah? And also we talk about how does the risk appetite in one part of the organization be better than the rest of the organization? And how do you have different goals and strategies for one set of people, and even probably, you know, compensation as well as rewarding mechanism. How can it be different? And very important is also that, you know, how do these teams blend into this bigger business without being resented by others? So they are always being, you know, talked about as special team, right? So these are some of the questions what we have. And I can give some examples maybe from Bosch. And inside Bosch, what we do is that entrepreneurship is categorized into three parts. One is core business, the second one is adjacency to core, And the third one is net new areas or the white spaces or the relatively newer topics. So one of an innovative project is approved to be taken up. The team structure is aligned to design thinking techniques. And what we do is that we also run some kind of an accelerator program where this team is mentored by some expert, innovation expert, and we get trained on business model, customer development model, agile methods and other things, because most of them are what we're talking about are techies and they are not aware of some of them. So we also have a formal mechanism to train them. But the goal is inherently that you need to resolve the tension of innovating a new business while running a high performance business at the same time. That is where always the conflicts come. And this is where there is something which is called a tick box approach. So this is proposed by Mr. Govindarajan, and in Bosch we are big fans of it. So it talks about three boxes. The box one, which talks about present, box two talking about the past, and three talking about the future, right? So in the box one, it talks about managing the present, which means that you need to look at ways of optimizing the current business, and you run the core business at the peak performance. Yeah? So that is one. And the second one is selectively forget the past. So companies which have existed for 150 years, we are all blinded by the prior success and the past experience, and you want to stick to what we have followed so far. Very, very difficult, because we are so much attached to what we have achieved, and even when the investment is now longer paying off, we don't want to give up on it, right? So I think I was reading a quote which was telling that almost 88% of the company which was listed in the Fortune 500 list a couple of decades back, it seems 88% are no longer listed because they are either merged or they were acquired, they went bankrupt, or they are non-existent. So which means that if you want something new, it is very clear that you need to stop doing something old. So some innovative, some actions have to be killed from the past if you want to move on, and this has to be done at the right time without wasting much of resources and money. So coming to the box three is the future. So this is creating the future, and here what we do is we set up small team within this large company, dedicated teams to work on certain ideas and topics, and this team is isolated from certain structures. For example, the standard one, you need to follow the logistics and purchase and many other things. So we try to isolate them so that they focus on innovation and things like that, and not too much on the structure which a corporate cannot live without. And even HR metrics are being for appraisers are also being changed now to adapt to these kind of things. So this is the change which we are doing it, and with these majority of the conflicts what you spoke about with respect to strategy, leadership and others, to a great extent we are able to solve this now.
Wow, sure. Thanks, Lata. That was a great insight into having the three boxes. How did you put it across and try to resolve the conflicts that arise? So thanks for your insight. Taking the same thread, Shiva, I'm sure you'd have come across different types of tools or programs or infrastructure in your organization also. So would you like to share more on around these three programs or the tools that could be used to catalyze the growth of intrapreneurial leadership culture within any organization?
You're not audible, Shiva.
No. Looks like now. Shiva? Shiva, try now. No. Shiva, you might want to try the other way. No. You want to switch back the microphone, Shiva? Okay, Shiva, I'll come back while you set up the microphone back. Sumita, can I request you to share your thoughts on how do we sustain it? See, any program or any change or any innovation, you know, kind of stuff, you know, we can start with, you know, all the, you know, pre-planning and, you know, coming together and all, correct? With lots of, you know, planning and, you know, as a, you know, team. How do you sustain it? So definitely there's, you know, the challenge that each one of us face. So could you share your thoughts on sustaining the intrapreneurship?
So I think one of the ways of sustaining this, Pushpa, is actually to create the change at source, which means that if you want, entrepreneurship cannot be just a top-down goal. It has to be felt by individuals. Each one in the organization needs to feel that this is important, this benefits them, and they get the support to be able to really innovate. I really like what Lata mentioned, and a lot of the work that senior leaders have to do is exactly resolving the tension between innovation versus running a business. And that's where, like, for example, if you look at Nokia, completely losing their business to Apple, was exactly that. Like, how do you resolve the tension of, let's create innovation rather than running a business which is running well now, but you don't know whether it will. And Steve Jobs is a great example of this, because he constantly says that you can't just create a product. You have to think about what people aspire for in the future and solve for that aspiration. So that means that change really, the spirit of innovation has to be there at every individual, from the person who's creating a little button in a phone to a person who's creating just the cover or the UI. It's a lot. Like, it's like a supply chain. Everyone has to be innovating. Also, we have to, again, Lata mentioned, we have to selectively forget the past. You have to forget the past and move on. The four ways I would say you can sustain innovation is, one, always create curiosity, ask a lot of leading questions. And I took you back to the example that I had when a manager first asked me a lot of questions, which empowered me to think that I can actually innovate and make changes at my level. So create the curiosity top down. Everyone really needs to feel like they have a stake in the organization to make change. Second is, there is an excellent HBR article on acting like an entrepreneur inside your organization. And that talks about something where successful entrepreneurs don't try and calculate what they will ultimately get from their efforts. So they are not doing innovation because they have an aspiration to get awarded. But their question is, what will I lose in the process? So a lot of people think of innovation as an inacceptable loss framework than expected return framework, which means that people really worry that if they take risks and if they lose, then do their managers, do their leaders have their backs? Are they going to support failure? So that's the second most important thing. The third thing is really creating agents and change agents who are advising individuals, supporting them, having your back. And the reason it is important is it should not be just the direct line management that should be driving it, but it should be the entire org that should say that even if somebody does not report to me, I'm going to have their back if they're doing something really important. And last is speed of execution. Like, a lot of time we are lost in the analysis paralysis mode. And I think sometimes you have to just do, iterate, fail, and keep doing that. And these are four ways I think you can sustain on.
Great to know that. Thanks, Sunita. Lata, extending the same thing, right? So the same thread from Sunita. So what do you think, a couple of organizational antibodies that keep innovative ideas and, like in addressing them? So would you like to share your thoughts?
Yeah, okay. I think antibodies in the corona times, you always remember that. And I would say the reason here we have started to use these kind of jargons like, innovation antibodies. Yeah, just to tell, it is nothing but it is used to describe some of the challenges in managing innovation, specifically in larger organizations which are struggling to find their own innovation culture. So, I would define that, Pushpa's jargon like that. Yeah. So, change is frightening to many elements inside a typical organization. Yeah, and this could threaten people's power. It could threaten egos. It can even make some people's competence and existence obsolete in an organization. And the fear of cannibalization is also a very strong reason for antibody. But like the human body, I would like to say that antibodies can have positive impact and it can also have a negative impact, right? So there are the antibodies, the positive ones, which are useful for the organization because they actually do a lot of challenging the status quo, challenging the new ideas, yeah? And also offer a lot of critical thinking, which is a very positive. And there are the negative ones who actually fight to, kill innovation and maintain the status quo. That is the whole idea, yeah? So when you look at corporate, I'm sure that there are certain statements which are very familiar. And I would say that I've heard it a million times, yeah? One is that, we have tried it long back. It did not work. This idea did not. And I tried this idea. The second is, from the top, you might sometimes hear the thing that I support innovation, but this is not the right time I will invest on it, yeah? Then the third one is like, our business is, profitable right now. I don't want to derail it. It is working smooth. I don't want to change. And the finance guy always coming and tell that, don't rock the boat. I don't see the ROI. So these are standard, questions and statements that we hear in our organization. And so it common across, not only specific to one. But what we need to understand that, these guys who make these statements are really not the bad guys. They actually genuinely think that they have the best interest of their company in the mind. And some of these people become antibodies also because they have been seniors in the company, they have been there for a very long time, and they somehow feel that their opinions don't carry enough weight in this kind of a new scenario. It is also a little bit psychological part, right? So I would say there are a few mantras to turn it around. So the first thing is know your area and know your ideas very well. Know your antibodies also very well. Very important, yeah? So you craft your story and get them endorsed your idea and ask them to contribute. They cannot back up, yeah, because they are part of it now. So which means that what we are trying to do, we are actually trying to make people backers than blockers. So we are converting them from a blocker to a backer. So this is not easy. It's very easy to speak, but it's not very easy. I'm sure that Sunita is smiling. So I'm sure, this is a problem that we happens in every organization. This needs a lot of stakeholder analysis, which we need to do in the beginning itself. And also a proactive communication to facilitate knowledge sharing, as well as building of new relationships that can broaden the perspective, everyone's perspective. So this is really critical. The second mantra I would say is stay below the radar. Yeah, in some situations, the best choice is to stay below the radar as long as possible. Not always, sometimes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So don't become too interesting too early. What happens is if it, it helps you to avoid people who can steal ideas sometimes. And it can also, there are some structures, there are some people in the organization who will right away want to apply guidelines and corporate processes into your system, which can actually kill that whole innovation and whole idea. So this is something which need to be, wary about. And the last one is, I would say, you need to provide a high amount of autonomy to these leaders or mentors who are running the entrepreneurship. And in large organizations, you need actually innovation council, which has high autonomy, and they should have their own budget and resources so that they can actually get away from the damage that can be done by the antibodies. This is very critical. So self-appointed entrepreneurs, they cannot be traditional managers. The ones who run the show, who own the show, they cannot be really traditional managers. And they should have a high scorecard on positivity to manage this. Yeah? The second thing is they need to have a collaborative mindset. They also need to have a high resilience to withstand all these things. And a lot of, I would say, interest for practical work as well as critical thinking. So with these things in mind, these things in place, I think to a large extent, the organizational antibody can be managed well. And it can be, I would say, the harness, the positive can be harnessed very well.
Sure. Thanks, Lata, for the
discussion. Hey, can you hear me now?
Yes. Yeah. And thank you for... your time, okay.
Yeah, I'm on the phone also now. So
okay, thanks, Shiva. Okay, let me repeat the question, Shiva. So I would like to extend the thought process that we covered in the discussions, right, by Sunita. the tools in the infrastructure, that can be used to catalyze the intrapreneurship, the journey within an organization. So I'd like to share your thoughts on that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I mean, from within my own organization, there's a few things that we do, in order to keep this whole intrapreneurial thought process going. One is, as a process, it's almost like a part of our culture to do this, is, we have what we call intern programs. We have intern programs where we bring in, fresh graduates, people who are in their final year, seventh or eighth semesters, as part of our internship programs. What we do is that is almost like we use them on incubation types of ideas. And they're going to be coordinating with or working with a lot of our senior people, senior technologists who are working on part of our products. They kind of use those guys as their hands and legs to kind of evaluate new ideas. I can give you a very recent example. We have one of my products is an auction site. Within my team, I have like 7 or 8 products that we manage. One of them is an auction site. It's been around for a while, to the point that Lata was making earlier. You can't get too passionate about something that's been around. How do you take it to the next level? You can't constantly do that while you're also meeting with your business needs. So use this incubator to say, hey guys, what can we do with this? Come up with new ideas. And believe me, the ideas that came were really awesome. We've got not just a new skin, but just features that are very different, very contemporary to what a modern market would need. So that intern program has been pretty successful. The other thing that we do is what we call hackathons. These happen at regular intervals. We kind of create ideas around the business things that we want to solve for, that we may just put away like 2 to 3 weeks of time. Maybe 2 days a week, the guys are on full time on that, but then through the 3 weeks, they come up with ideas, they come together, band together. And this is, it can be anybody, not just your own team, but teams around you that can come together to deep dive on the idea. And things that come out of those ideas, there have been several of those ideas that have actually gone on to become products. The third thing is what I would say is part of our product development itself. We have, I think Sunita mentioned this, we have an idea board. It's part of our product management. Anybody on the team can put on ideas based on the products that they're seeing. Those ideas are constantly evaluated. And when you're evaluating them, they become potentially features to your existing product, potentially create a new product like Digital Expert. Then we have demo days, demo bars, lots of things that we do to keep that going. And finally, it has to be coming from everybody on the team. It's not just like this 2-3 people that are doing it. So making it part of the culture is almost like a tool. For you,
sure.
Hopefully that helps.
Definitely, Shiva. Yeah, thank you. In fact, I could see lots of questions coming from the audience already. We would like to take a couple of them in the interest of time. One is how do companies manage to create a secure environment for the employees try and fail. We have spoken about fail fast and then try, to think through or ideate your thoughts and all. So how do an organization can create an environment, to do that, to encourage more and more on the innovation?
Mm-hmm. Pushpa, I can take that. So one of the things, I think we say fail early and fail fast, which is be very iterative in the process, mm-hmm. and to pick it. How do you create a culture? I think one is rewarding failure. Like if you see a lot of organizations have rewards and recognitions, mm-hmm. or even your performance management, which is all tuned to looking at impact. And impact usually means that the project is successful. Otherwise, you don't have an impact. So I think a lot during a huge transformational part of my team, the person safety team, our VP was trying to change the way we were doing things. And we realized through a lot of iteration that just doing the lip service was not helping. And so we actually created ways to recognize the risky innovators. So we looked at projects which had failed, which had a great idea, where procedures were followed and how. It is not like you picked an idea and you failed, so you're going to get awarded to it. But people had great efforts behind it. They had done the right analysis, and yet the outcome was not suitable. I think those are ones that we really looked and said, we are going to actually call out the risky innovators. We are going to make them role models in the organization, because they have really had taken the effort, and we even awarded them in PERF in terms of, yeah, not pulling down someone's performance or rating or a promotion because they failed in a project, but they actually had the ability to take a large risk and steer the organization towards a new direction. So some of this really comes in making changes. And we always, in Google, we said people experience, and people experience are those points of experience, which is performance management. That is my point of experience as an individual. If I don't get rated correctly, my compensation is not according. So I will not innovate if I don't. So that's really important to me. Recognition is important. How I get awarded? Am I a role model in the organization? That's my social belonging in an organization. So it's very important for us to understand what are these points of experiences and how are you creating methods of rewarding and recognizing people at points of experience for failures, mm-hmm. and you provide them a lot of safety net and support as a management team so that we nurture the ability for people to take risks.
Sure.
Yeah, excellent point, Sunita. I really, you know, agree with it that, you know, we need to actually balance this rewarding system between you know, failures, and we should also be cautious about what kind of failures we reward. So that actually is, you know, it's pretty much important. We cannot reward all kinds of failures. But in the entrepreneurship, actually, it becomes very, very important. And I like this question. You talked about, you know, how do you create a secure environment? Entrepreneurship, entrepreneurs normally don't require, you know, security so much. They are daring, they are bold, they are willing to take risks, they are positive, they are resilient. Yeah. So, but I understand, I mean, that's on the lighter side, but I understand the question. The organization culture has to change a lot, and we need to be more tolerant to failure. But I would say the mindset is, you know, you need to be, you know, seeking an adventure. It's like seeking an adventure, taking a risk, and you need to go into that with your full heart and full passion, and it will work. Then you don't look too much of security, because you will be successful.
Right. Yeah. Thanks, Lata. So I think, yeah, we have lots of questions coming through from the audience side. I don't think that we do have time. So yeah, let us see whether we can address them, you know, on the networking side. Yeah, so with that, maybe I would like to, you know, request each one of you to share your final two tips or parting thoughts, okay, on the entrepreneurship, so that hopefully that might address a couple of questions here. So that's what I would say, looking at the time. Yeah, Shiva, would you like to go first?
Sure. So, I mean, if I had to summarize this, I mean, firstly, a lot of things that Smita and Lata mentioned totally resonate with me, because we are all experiments in the similar setup.
Right.
If I have, I mean, the two takeaways from me is, one is be curious. Be curious, be passionate. That's going to make the difference, because if you're not curious and passionate, I can create an environment for you, but unless you bring that insight, it's not going to help with being an entrepreneur. The other one is be passionate about your idea, but at the same time, be dispassionate about it, in the sense that if it doesn't work, you should be okay to move on. And, you know, when you have an idea, there are going to be people who are going to question it, you know, may have even come as detractors. You must be okay to face them. And that's where the being dispassionate helps. I think culture of innovation starts from the top. So all of these things are the three or four key takeaways, I would say. I don't want to steal the thunder, because I'm sure Rasunita and Lata also have additional
thanks, Shiva.
Thank you.
I can go next. I mean, echoing everything Shiva said, curiosity I think is the key to innovation. I have three quick thoughts. One is build a risk appetite in the team, because like I mentioned, this HBR article which says people worry about what they lose and not what they really have to gain. So how does management create psychological safety and have backs of individuals? That's really important. So that's one. Second is, I think I'll again harp on this, reward and recognize the risk appetite. And that's really important, because that's what fosters the whole culture of innovation in an organization. And third is, keep this whole ability, especially as senior leaders, to ask questions every time. How are you going to make this change? What are you going to do? Because that's the only way you can empower people to be change agents. And you will really foster resilience if you are asking the question top down.
Sure. Thanks, Sunita.
Okay. I think really good point from Shiva and Sunita. What I wanted to say is that, you know, sometimes there are no old roads to new directions. Yeah, so you need to change the roles. So it takes a lot of passion, curiosity, hard work, and positivity, and more than anything, the desire to make an impact with an entrepreneurship practice. So that is the key there. And once an idea is identified and approved, you need to create, you know, a dedicated team, which is the box three, which I spoke about. Yeah? And we also need to have a good buy-in from the top management for the resources and the funding. Very important is also the guy or the lady who leads, you know, the teams, because it needs to be a visionary and they have to be the right mindset and the accountability. And also, how do you handle the antibodies effectively, so that it can be used as an energy in the organization rather than any, a negative mindset. So this I need to have a look at it, and we need to have a very lean structure and a climate where the trial and error method has to be, encouraged. And again, coming back to the point what Sunita mentioned, failures should be allowed, encouraged, and it has to happen if you want to create something new. And on a good note, I would say that remember there are two good benefits when a failure happens, right? First of all, if you fail, you will learn what doesn't work, number one. Yeah. The second thing is that failure will give you the opportunity to try a new approach. So it's okay to fail. So this is something which we also need to tell our team that, you know, it's okay. The other topic which I also feel is important is, we need to have innovative free working spaces, which now the companies are looking at, innovation hubs and special working places where people can meet together and do. And also a reward philosophy, which is based on the value creation that the employees do. So this is very critical, and it's very important to protect these teams from these bureaucratic approaches or rigid processes, and in the beginning, so that they are free to think and innovate. So this is very important. So I would like to summarize by telling that entrepreneurship is an attitude. It is not a department or a unit inside an organization, and we need to treat it that
way. Sure. Great. Thank you so much, Lata, Sumita, Shiva, for your excellent time and lots of inspirational thoughts through your experience. I'm sure audience would have, I could see that, very clearly coming out of, very evident out of the questions coming through on the chat. So it's still growing, okay? So we'll try to address offline. So thanks again for your time and then sharing your inspirational thoughts. I'm sure we can see many more innovators starting from now. So I'm reinforcing your thoughts, okay? Thanks again.
Thank you, Pushpa. It was a pleasure being in this panel.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Lata, Shiva,
and thanks, Shiva, Sunita. It was really a pleasure. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks. Yeah. Husseina? I would like to thank the audience keeping so active and then sharing the thoughts and questions on the stage. Husseina, would you like to bring now the quiz questions for the audience?
Sure. Thanks, Pushpa. So we have a couple of quiz questions for the audience. We'll read out the first one. So as Pushpa has mentioned that Google had immensely gained from the project. So can some of initially 20% faster innovation internally. Let's post it on the stage chat. So, typing.
Husseina, you are breaking. Husseina, can you try now? I couldn't hear you. Husseina? Husseina, able to hear me? Looks like we lost Husseina. So are we time up? Neelam, Usha, maybe I